Good evening. The theme of this year's Reith Lectures is age, how we're programmed to survive, not to die. We began in London with our first lecture looking at the effects of increased longevity on society. Then we travelled to New York, where we learned about the role which DNA, the thread of life, plays in determining whether and how we grow old. Now we've come to Edinburgh, and you'd be an unusual human being if you didn't have a great interest in the two topics of our lecture here tonight. They are sex and death. Why do women live longer than men? And why in the whole history of evolution are we, the female of the human species, allowed to live on long after our ability to reproduce? Fundamental and fascinating issues. We're at the Royal Museum as part of the Edinburgh International Science Festival, and our audience contains both distinguished academics and members of the public. We look forward to taking questions and comments from both groups later on. But first, may I ask you to welcome the Professor of Medicine and Head of Gerontology at Newcastle University, this year's Reith Lecturer, Tom Kirkwood.
Good evening. The greatest physical asset of any of us, even those as well endowed in other respects as Dolly Parton or Arnold Schwarzenegger, is the soft grey hemisphere that sits between our ears. The human brain is a masterpiece of evolution, but it does complicate our lives, and nowhere is this more apparent than when we struggle with the big questions of sex and death. It could be said that the trouble started with Aristotle, who believed that each sex act had a direct life-shortening effect. We see many centuries later this troubling idea surfacing in the work of the metaphysical poets. It would be hard to find gloomier expression than John Donne's mournful musing. Since each such act, they say, diminisheth the length of life a day, I'll no more dote and run to pursue things which hath in damaged me. Now, if you were to ask the male praying mantis being eaten by his bride during the act of copulation whether the metaphysical poets were correct that the orgasm is a little death, he would probably agree. He might even drop the word little. You might get the same answer from the Pacific salmon, which spawns but once and dies. But is it true of you and me? Does sex shorten our lives? Can it be, as some have suggested, that aging and death are the price we pay for sex? Does it make sense to think in terms of a reproductive duty to the species, leaving us surplus to requirement when duty is done? And what, if these worrying notions are true, are we to make of the postmenopausal woman? These are the questions that I shall examine in today's lecture, and I shall hope to show you that the answers are not only reassuring on the whole, but also that they tell us a great deal about the biological background to our revolution in longevity. In fact, Aristotle was right. There is a relationship between sex and death, but it's even more interesting than Aristotle suspected. The catalytic insight came in 1881 from the distinguished German naturalist August Weismann. What Weismann realized was that in a multicellular body like yours and mine, there's a profound division of labor between two principal kinds of cells. On the one hand, there's the germline, the egg or sperm-forming cells of the ovary or testis. These are the cells that, if we have children, transmit our genes into the next generation. The rest of the cells, those that make up the other organs of the body, Weismann termed the soma. In the early stages of life on planet Earth, before the distinction between germline and somatic cells evolved, the responsibility for generating new individuals was shared by every cell. Indeed, most organisms were probably unicellular, and their descendants are with us today, bacteria, amoebae, and the like. But as cells came to live in clumps of genetically identical clones, the separation of germline and soma offered wonderful new opportunities for some of the cells, freed from the need to support procreation, to become specialists. In our bodies today, we find red blood cells specialized for transporting oxygen and other constituents around the body. We find white blood cells designed to police the body for intruders and destroy them. We find brain and nerve cells engineered for the conduction of electrical signals. We find the cells of the lens of the eye uniquely translucent in order to transmit and focus light upon the retina. It would be hard to imagine how such diverse specialisms could be supported if each of the cells needed also to retain the capacity to produce a new baby. The distinction between germline and soma enabled such extraordinary advances in the evolution of the higher forms of life that we might almost forgive the terrible price that we have paid. For it was this, not sex, that caused us to age and die. There are species that age and don't have sex, like parthenogenetic whiptail lizards. And there are species that have sex and don't age, like the freshwater hydra. Although hydra are capable of sex, they don't often bother and make do instead with vegetative reproduction by budding. Almost any part of a hydra can generate a new individual. Its germline permeates its body and it has no real soma to speak of. It's this lack of a distinction between the germline and the soma that allows hydra to evade the aging process. The presence or absence of aging is always associated, as far as we know, with the presence or absence of the soma-germline distinction. To understand why the soma-germline distinction is so important for aging, we should first observe that the germline simply cannot be allowed to fail in its duty of keeping going indefinitely. If it did, if, for example, it permitted cumulative damage to build up in its DNA sequence, it would rapidly become extinct. Some change to the DNA sequence must, of course, occur, since otherwise evolution would be stalled. But the kind of damage that builds up in the somatic cells of our bodies during our lifetime would be intolerable if it were to occur to a similar extent in the germline. This immortality of the germline is not a theoretical concept. It's as real as life itself. Each of us could, if the records were available, trace our ancestry back to the very earliest cellular forms of life on Earth. Throughout the billions of years of evolutionary history, an unbroken chain of cell divisions has made us what we are today. When we consider the soma, however, we find that there's no corresponding requirement for somatic cells to keep their DNA in good shape indefinitely. We have nothing of either parent's soma in us, and there's nothing of our soma in our children. It just doesn't matter, biologically speaking, if our somatic cells eventually fall apart. The somatic cells comprise the individual, and that, important as it may be to you and me, is all that they will ever be required to do. Life in the natural world is brutish and short. All that the organism needs from its somatic cells is that they can keep the soma in good enough shape until an age when the likelihood of still being alive is negligible. When we factor in the consideration that the maintenance and repair of somatic cells doesn't come cheap, it makes sense to trim back the maintenance of somatic cells and divert the energy thereby saved into helping with the all-important business of reproduction. The result was that the soma became disposable, and with that came aging. It was in 1977 that this realization came to me, a eureka moment that happened appropriately enough as I took my bath. At the time, the idea was highly controversial because the prevailing view then was that aging is programmed. But in the years since, the evidence in support of the disposable soma theory, as the idea is called, has become strong. It's this idea that teaches us to understand that the primary cause of aging is the gradual build-up of faults in the cells and organs of the body. It's always exceptional.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.